Party girl, don't get hurt, can't feel anything. When will I learn? I push it down, I push it down. See, I'm the one for a good time, call phones blowing up. I'm ringing my doorbell, I feel the love, feel the love. One, two, three, one, two, three, three. One, two, three, one, two, three, three. One, two, three, one, two, three, three. Zoom back till I lose count. I'm gonna swing from the chandelier, from the chandelier. I'm gonna leave like tomorrow doesn't exist, like it doesn't exist. Down, won't open my eyes. Keep my glass full until morning light. Cause I'm just holding on for tonight. Help me, I'm holding on for dear life. Won't look down, won't open my eyes. Keep my glass full until morning light. Cause I'm just holding on for tonight. On for tonight. Sun is up, I'm a mess. Gotta get out now.
Magic on, or me she'd say, everything you want to dream away, and we are legends every day, that's what she told me. I feel my heart beating, I feel my heart underneath my skin, I feel my heart beating, cause you make me feel like I'm alive. I'm alive again.
Yeah. Graham, will you take Louise to be your wife? Will you love her, comfort her, honour and protect her, and forsaking all others, be faithful to her as long as you both shall live?
I will.
Louise, will you take Graham to be your husband? Will you love him, comfort him, honour and protect him, and forsaking all others, be faithful to him as long as you both shall live?
I will.
Will you, the family and friends of Graham and Louise, support and uphold them in their marriage now and in the years to come?
We will.
After the last scene of my life flashed before me, I looked back at the footprints in the sand. I noticed that at many times along the path of my life, especially at the very lowest and saddest times, there was only one set of footprints. This really troubled me, so I asked the Lord about it. Lord, you said once I decided to follow you, you'd walk with me all the way. But I noticed that during the saddest and most troublesome times of my life, there was only one set of footprints. I don't understand why, when I needed you the most, you'd leave me. He whispered, "My precious child, I love you and I will never leave you, never ever during your trials and testings. When you saw only one set of footprints, it was then that I carried you."
Sail away with me and be my love. We'll lay and watch the skies above. I'll take you out upon the sea and show you what it means to me. The wind will be calm, yet lightly blowing. The cabin's warm with oils glowing. Just think of us upon this ocean, sipping tea as a soothing potion. Upon the deck, we watch the world go by. Tranquil seas glisten, birds fly high. Reminiscing of the time we met, happy knowing we will never forget. We'll climb up high into the rig above to share the starry night with you, my love. The sails will be full with autumn's breeze, overlooking Cornwall's glowing seas. Precious few have answered our ocean's calling. We've waited this long, now we're truly falling. So take my hand and fly like a dove to sail with me and be my love.
And now, in the wonderful sense of not being quite sure what's going to happen, Nathan is going to read
Well, I'm just going to read another poem. Graham and Louise have asked me to read one of my own poems, which I'm delighted to, very honoured to do. It's a bit of a team effort, actually. You can see it's been beautifully decorated here by some of the younger members of the Assembly. So I've just done these two lovely golden hearts, and Eliza and Cedar have done this wonderful artwork here, which I'm reflects the themes of the poem. In any case, so I think you'll agree, this side is magnificent. They were working late into the night, and this is magnificent. This side, not quite right. The metering is perfect. The rhyming a delight. But something is missing. Something is missing. I can't shake this conviction. Is it the way that I read it? My timing or diction? Is the content the problem? No, ce n'est pas. I know that there's something, but je ne sais quoi. I mean, it meets all the criteria of a decent love poem. I don't know much French, but I've shoved all I know in, and I think that's romantic. Je t'aime, je t'adore. But if that's not enough, check it out. It's got more. It's got whining and dining and love at first sight. It's got will she or won't she? I think that she might. It's got moonlight and music and strolls in the park. I couldn't find a lovebird but managed a lark. It's got candlelit dinners. It's got Cupid's bow. It's got late nights and lions with nowhere to go. It's got pillow talk, pet names, chocolate and roses. That very first kiss with the bumping of noses, dilated pupils. It's down on one knee. It's everything that a love poem should be. And yet something is missing, which I cannot see, but something is definitely missing. All of that said, I'm going to give it a go. I mean, I'm here now, I've got it, and so I might as well speak it, perform it aloud. To who? To you guys. A crowd. This is a poem to be read to a lover. Somebody close, a significant other. It's to whisper into a partner's ear. It's not a piece for you all to hear. That's the thing that's missing. I should have known it. A love poem is pointless if there's no one there to own it. So it's pointless because it's loveless. I'm sure everyone understands. It's like a man buying gloves when he hasn't any hands. It's such a pity because it's finished. It's written, complete. The rhyming's impressive. The sentiment's sweet. Look, if anybody wants it, if you're a little bit like me and like the thought of being written some romantic poetry, then a little bit later, once they've said their I do's, come and introduce yourself. You've nothing to lose. It's a single love poem, looking for friendship, maybe more. It's shy, untouched, never been read before. It's recently written, effectively new, but it feels something's missing, and it's hoping that's you. We'd like you to have this. I'll give it to your best.
Amazing. Thank you.
Well, I think Graham and Louise have got three very important things going for them as they begin their life together. And the first of these things is who they are. They've met later in life, they've got life a bit sussed. They've had some great time together. I'm told their first date, they caught 18 mackerel. And they've had plenty of time to go in fishing since, and beaches, barbecues, and love and laughter, and the challenge of moving house and living with all that attention. Every bit of attention that's gone, detail that's gone into making this wedding happen, you can see that happening in making your home beautiful as well, but on the way, the rats in the kitchen and the lack of central heating and the outdoor toilet and things we won't mention. We are know that it's on its way, well on its way to be a beautiful home, and we trust that you'll be very happy together. But of course, who you are isn't just who you are individually, it's who you are as a couple. And it's been lovely hearing those poems that have been written and chosen especially for you, all about the importance of love.
Good afternoon on this joyous day. I have to say this is a very emotional time for me, Graham, Tim and Nikki, our sister, because it is now 10 years ago that Mike died and Rosemary died more recently. There is no doubt that they would have been absolutely joyous to have been here today to see Graham marry Louise. Such a lovely girl. We've got to know her over the last year or so, and she's absolutely lovely. Graham has asked me to read a couple of things, and I'm going to read you now what he has asked me to say. I'm Robin. I'm Graham's oldest uncle. Well, thanks very much, Graham. That's very kind. That makes me sound pretty ancient, doesn't it, Graham? Graham has asked me to read two items, a prayer of remembrance, which he's written, and a brief letter to Graham from his mother, Rosemary, before she died. So we start with the prayer. Lord, we thank you for this wonderful day and give special thought to Rosemary and Michael, who are here in spirit and soul, but not body. They would have been and are, of course, thrilled to see Louise become part of our family and marrying Graham today. Can we now spend a few moments thinking of Mike and Rosemary and also late family and friends who are so dear to us and not here today. I've been told I needed to wait 45 seconds, but 45 seconds is a heck of a long time. the letter. This is now the letter written by Rosemary, Graham's mum, before she died. To my dear son, Graham, I hope you will be pleased with these little but precious heirlooms. Do treasure these things and pass them on to your own children in time. I hope they will be a happy reminder of your early family days, not forgetting the cats and chickens, of course. So goodbye until we meet again in the next life. Live your life to the full. Try to accept criticism graciously. It is usually well meant. Seek wisdom and pray. Never lose your honesty with people and your compassion for those who suffer. Don't forget, my love is always with you. God bless, Mum.
I, Graham Fernley.
Take you, Louise.
To be my wife.
To have and to hold.
From this day forward.
For better, for worse.
For richer, for poorer.
In sickness and in health.
To love and to cherish.
Till death us do part.
According to God's holy law.
In the presence of God.
I make this vow. Thank you. Would you loose hands? Out. You take joined hands again, but this time, Louise, your hand is under Graham's hand, so you're holding Graham's hand. Beautiful. I, Louise. Take you, Graham Fernley. To be my husband.
To have and to hold.
From this day forward. For better, for worse.
For richer, for poorer.
In sickness and in health. To love and to cherish.
Till death us do part.
According to God's holy law.
In the presence of God. In the presence of God.
I make this vow. Thank you.
Those whom God has joined together, let no one put asunder.
Thank you. Graham, you may now kiss the bride.
This day. Bless you both.
How to be brave? How can I love when I'm afraid? A little bit of a round of applause, please, here for Sean.
Hey.
Steady the ship, steady the nerves.
Best dad in the world here.
I'll get my glasses on first.
There we go. We're just waiting for the spectacles. Let's hope it's large text.
That's it, that'll do.
Okay, I'll hand over to the father of the bride.
Thank you. Thank you, Danny. Is it working?
Yeah,
it's working. Hello? Yes, right. Right, here we go. A bit quite serious now. You know, look at this. As I look at my daughter today, I can't help but remember all the years I was lucky enough to watch her grow and become this beautiful woman she is today.
Hold it close to your mouth, sir.
She catches my heart. She catches my heart on the day she was born. She's my little girl, my princess, and my ray of sunlight. And no matter what her age, she would always be those things to me. I'll get to this yet. Right. But today, as I watch you marry a wonderful man, I'm filled with pride. I am confident that Louise and Graham will embark on a wonderful journey together, filled with love and happiness that will continue to grow, that they are man and wife. May the two of you treat each other with love, compassion, and kindness. I ask you all now to join me in congratulating the bride and groom and wishing them all the best for a long and happy life together. The bride and groom. Bride and groom.
Ladies and gentlemen, can I have your attention, please? Everyone simmer down now. I know the temperature is rising, but it's come to that point in the afternoon where we get to eat. I have tried to slim down into this suit, but didn't quite make it, so excuse me. Anyway, it gives me great pleasure to welcome Mr. and Mrs. Parker to their wedding. If we could all be upstanding, please. If you could all be sat. If I could have your attention, please, I've just got a slight announcement to make for you. Ladies and gentlemen, quiet, please. When you're ready.
Sorry, Dad.
Father-in-law. Okay. At last, welcome to this, the Harbour Wedding 2018.
Of the century.
.co.uk. My name is Danny Trick, and I'm delighted to be first mate and to welcome you all aboard. Just a few things to mention before we set sail. Fire exits are located here, here, and to the rear.
And your life jacket is under the seat.
My cabin crew, actually they're still parking the boat, are here primarily for your safety when they return. So my stewardesses, Andy, Tom and Vinny, are on hand to meet all your needs. Bridesmaids, please be aware that Vinny is trained in CPR. And if Vinny was here, I was going to say, Kate, Vinny, Vinny, Kate, but he isn't. So you'll have to meet later. Marshall's here. He's his father. He's got more experience. Louise, you'll find a jacket under your chair. Only joking, it's over here. But if you're asked by your captain to brace, 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 then the wedding has gone much faster than we imagined. If I could all ask you to switch all portable babies to mute and only use emergency frequencies to reduce the commotion in the ocean. Toilets are located through that door, through the exit, up the stairs, with disabled and OOP toilets being off the balcony, or for Phil down the lift. Although I have looked how many kilograms it takes. We'll get you another two. If you've... hang on, where are we, T? He threw me with his chair thing. Phil, we didn't rehearse that, did we? Okay. If the floor lights up, you've probably drifted off during Graham's speech. And Cornwall's best jazz band, Grace Notes, has striked up. We're really looking forward to welcoming them to the stage, along with the other guests we actually wanted here today. Should the first dance show any signs of cracks, I've asked them to play on regardless. Graham, the captain, must go down with the ship. Passengers are advised, when Phil exits his seat, his belt may be unfastened. Where's Dave? Dave Wicks?
Yep.
Dave, in the unlikely event that you exit the bar area and enter onto the dance floor on an inflatable slide, I remind you to take off your high heels. Steve, where are you? Oh, I can hear him. I can't smell him. Where is he? There he is. Steve, we remind you that this is a non-smoking ocean liner. And Andy, who's not here, we'll have to remind him later, because he's on that boat. There are no e-cigs. Should you wish to smoke, you'll notice that there is a balcony, but we'd like you to go down the steps, to the left and to the right, and not to smoke on the upper deck with upper class. Now, Graham doesn't brag about this, and I feel, as best man, it's my duty to address the elephant in the room. It's known to some that Graham is well endowed in his bank account. So I'm pleased to announce that there is a light refreshment trolley that will come around later this evening. And Parkair is laying on one club soda for each of you and a packet of nuts. No, I apologise, there are no free drinks. Nevertheless, can I ask you to be drink aware and drink responsibly during the course of this evening by buying me a drink when you see me at the bar. A card can be found on your table. See the postcard? Glamorously presented by all the ladies, look. Okay, where all the important wedding details can be found, such as our wedding partner's website and those wishing to donate to Parkair's charitable cause today, the so-called table fund, can do so online. If you want to tell my bosses, I mean the bride and groom, how wonderful I am, and what a great job I've done today, then please do write something on the postcard provided. There's also some Jenga blocks somewhere in this room. When we've located them, the bride and groom would like you to put a small memento onto that, whatever you wish, but do keep it clean, they may have kids one day. Ooh, it's hot up here. Lastly, please do share any photos or videos this weekend of the Facebook group Harbour Wedding Falmouth with the hashtag at last. We hope you enjoy your meal that's provided here today by the Greenbank Hotel. They made me say this, by the way, under duress. They said, oh, this isn't called the Harbour Wedding, it's called the Greenbank Hotel. So there we go, we've done that. They can pay me now. All right? No, not for you, because we know what you're going to see. Right, only leaves me to say we hope you enjoy your meal and the next speeches won't be till after main course. Thank you very much.
Ladies and gentlemen, the captain has turned on the fasten seatbelt signs. If you haven't already done so, please make your way to your seat, stowing away any handbags and food parcels under the table. So can you now please give us a raising welcome to the groom,
Come on.
Graham Parker, Big Cornubian cruise welcome as he embarks on his very own address to the passengers. Sorry, I mean guests.
Yeah, I know. Yeah. So thank you, everybody, for coming today. We've Louise and I thoroughly enjoyed it, and it's been remarkable. We've had an amazing day so far, and it's still going on. So this do is costing me an absolute fortune, but it is worth every penny. So we're very happy for today. I'd also very much like to thank Sean and Lynn, of course, Louise's parents, for their generous contributions for this day to help everything run and for all the work that they've done. So yeah. Thank you for that, guys. Thank you for that. Of course, Faye organised the Henley weekend, which the guys went on only last week. Yeah, which was close to the wire, but there was a festival going on, so it suited Louise. Can you still hear me back there?
Yes!
Great. Danny, you're going to have to work hard to...
No, it's a tough crowd.
Okay. I know Louise had a fantastic time for the Henley weekend. They went on some nice boats I've seen some pictures. I don't know if I've seen all the pictures, but I've seen some pictures that look pretty good. So I was thrilled that Louise had such a great time. Also, of course, let's not forget she had a hen weekend in Falmouth. A couple of months ago, which you also really enjoyed with your Falmouth crew. It was amazing. They went to see a vineyard over in Truro. Padstow, even. And then came back and had some drinks on board on our boat. Groomsman, Danny, what can I say? I was expecting a bit more of an effort from you, to be honest. No, Danny's been amazing, you know. He's been a friend of mine for many years now. 22 years. He's literally dedicated days to sort of get this together for us. The website, I know that took a lot of work. A lot of organisation. I've had two stag weekends. All organised by Danny. One in Germany for a couple of days. And one in Falmouth for the sea shanty when we were all on, well, a group of us were on the boat, my boat. And I mean, going back from the branding of our outfits to what we're going to eat, to what we're going to, you know, to wearing identical watches. I mean, the list goes on. I mean, Danny's been on it. Of course, when he planned his own wedding, it took him 3 years to plan. He's been in two magazines. Yeah. So yeah, there you go.
And the other magazine is Hope.
So yeah, so absolutely phenomenal work, Danny, and friendship. So I really appreciate that. Thank you so much. And of course, then on to my Uncle Robin, who I did ask if you'd kindly say a little remembrance. For people who've passed away, obviously people that you all know, maybe your mothers and fathers, maybe your friends, maybe your family, maybe your brother or sister, whoever. And of course, if you knew my parents or you thought of them for a moment, then that's really lovely, because obviously they aren't here. So I thought that was a really lovely little thing that Robin read out for me on my behalf. Very touching. So I used to live in Bristol, and then when I was about 14 years old or so, we moved to Falmouth. In particular, Greenbank is a special place for me because my parents had a house just along here. And before that, my grandfather also had a house along Greenbank many years ago. And I've got pictures of Robin, hand in the air, and Tim, both of my uncles, and Nikki, who unfortunately can't be here today. I've got pictures of, because she's got a stomach problem at the moment, very sadly. I've got pictures of them playing and swimming off the quay down here in Greenbank, which must have been at least 80 years ago, I'm not sure. How many?
90
for Robin, and Tim, 80 for you then, Tim, right?
Not allowed to jump off the end now.
So, my dad said to me just before he passed. He once looked up at me and said, Graham, he said, don't become a has-been. And I don't know if that's a real term or not, but what he meant by a has-been is don't be someone who's, you know, enjoyed life, maybe had one or two girlfriends, just, you know, doesn't really have a great direction. He was, his way of saying, you know, I was 32 at the time, I guess. So he was his way of saying, you know, maybe you need to sort of think about your future and just not work all the time. So, you know, he was aware that I could be possibly missing out on the amazing chance of a marriage with someone amazing and children and so on. So I took that into account, sorry.
It was worth waiting for.
And it was worth waiting for, absolutely, yeah. So I took that into account. It was two years ago to a couple of days, literally, that I was on a dating site, one of the better ones that you actually have to pay for. So I wasn't grinding and I wasn't flicking and I wasn't smiling or winking. If any of you know what that means, this is one you have to pay for. You could question you have to pay for it. Does it mean you're desperate or does it mean that you just think, no, I'm going to pay because I want some quality? Well, I decided to pay for it. And I found myself quite shortly to actually find a beautiful girl who lived just around the corner. Her name was Sally. No, her name was Louise. And we were communicating by message a couple of times. And then Vinny, hand in the air. Vinny said to me, Graham, let's go out for a quick drink. Let's go to the chain locker. You know, even though I don't drink, I'll have a lemonade. I'll go down there and have a drink with him. So that's what we did. We went down, we had a drink. And then I said to Vinny, I said, I'm sure that's a girl I've been speaking to a little bit on this dating website. And I said, I'm going to speak to her because she just walked straight past me with a friend, which was Kate. Give me a wave, Kate. Don't break the rule. And they walked past. And I said, yeah, I'm going to speak to her. I'm going to do this. Vinny was thinking, oh, it's going to be the wrong person. Something's going to happen. He'll probably get a punch or something. Or who knows? Anyway, and then Louise cascaded past with her long dress. And I stopped her in her flow. And I said, are you Louise? Yes, I am, she said, still not really knowing who I am, because probably, you know, there's been a lot of messages going around with a pretty girl like Louise. Anyway, and I soon realised it was Louise. So I said, so we confirmed our first date, which was great because it got things going. And it may well have been that if you hadn't have asked me out to go for that drink, we may not have had that date, because if any of you know, internet dating is very cold and hot and cold all the time. And these things don't often happen. So anyway, so we confirmed the date and we went on the date. And we went to the Pandora, which was a beautiful restaurant pub on the water. Went to the Pandora, and during this time, my cousins Emily and Becky and a few others were staying at the house. Where's Emily? There's Emily. Anyway, I was feeling a little bit under the weather, and Emily said to me, because I wasn't feeling sick, but almost sick. This was before my date, and Emily said to me, she said, Grey, because that's my family name. She said, Grey. No kissing, she said to me. Don't know if you remember that. Grey, no kissing. I said, that's fine, you know, just see how things go, you know. So we went out on our date. I actually picked her up, which is quite nerving when you pick someone up on a potential date and you're driving, because there's a lot to think about. And, well, not crashing the car, for example, you know. Which I did, yeah. So I'm getting to that bit in just a moment. Yeah, so we had a really nice date, and then I dropped her home, and then this car was coming down the other way, and I thought, I'll be a gentleman, I'll reverse up the hill and just slightly tuck myself in. I was in my Audi, which was quite a nice car at the time, and then I caught the bumper, and I said a four-letter word, I think. But I still kept myself under quite cool wraps, to be honest with you, because I would have said another word, and I would have got out the car straight away, but I just carried on driving in a cool fashion. I said, don't worry about it, don't worry. The car's spotless, but don't worry about it. So anyway, so I dropped Louise off, and yes, we did have just a little peck on the cheek. So then I got back to see my cousins, Emily, and and I said, Emily and Becky said, well, how did it go? Did you have a nice time? I said, yeah, I had a really nice time. And I did. and I explained that we did have a quick peck on the cheek, and I was told off. Case. So. Yes, that's right, yeah. 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 Yeah, that's right, yeah, yeah. In case I, you know, in case I was slightly ill, but I wasn't sure, but I didn't worry too much, I guess. You need to let someone know you're keen with someone, right? Anyway, shortly after that...
Who fixed the bumper anyway? Which young lady?
I went to what's it called? Chips Away.
All right.
Anyway, that's not in the speech, but they weren't great. They weren't great. Anyway, on our second date, we went on my boat. We took my boat out. We went to the lighthouse over there, the lighthouse, the secret spot Vinny taught me where you can potentially catch mackerel. So we went there, it was a beautiful evening, the sun was setting, it was about 5 or 6 in the afternoon, it was fantastic. Louise had some wine, and we listened to classic FM, and it was the best thing ever. And we caught about 12 mackerel, 18. And it was great. We came back in the dark because we were out for hours, and when we got to the quay, Louise said, well, shall I fillet the fish? I said, well, that would be quite handy, you know. So. We had a knife and she started filleting the fish on the quay. I said, have you done this before? Well, no, not really. I said, yeah, all right. So I got the trailer, I got the boat, I took it, I was just reversing it up. Gave Vinny a quick call because I thought I need to give him an update because let's be fair, he was the only one who'd met Louise out of my friends at the time. So I gave Vinny a call. I said, Vinny. So we had an amazing time. We went fishing, we drank some wine, we watched, listened to the music. I said, and you never guess what? She's only filleting the fish we just caught while I'm putting the boat away in the trailer. Vinny said, mate, she's a keeper. And I said, well, that's exactly what my thoughts were. And she's beautiful as well. So, you know. Anyway, we got on really well and our relationship grew. And Louise used to come round to see me with her little wooden wicker basket. And she's an amazing cook. And she would come round once and she'd cook something. And then she'd do it a couple more times. And I think that's when you really know you like someone, when you're thinking, when that person's just come round and you're thinking, oh, it'd be so great if I could see her again tomorrow or the day after. And you're thinking, and then suddenly that person, you know, identifies that she wants to do this, she or he wants to do the same thing, and she's already suggesting, well, I could come round tomorrow and we could do this or we could do that. And that was really when I knew we both had something really special. So I proposed to Louise, obviously, it was a few months ago, and I thought to myself, how am I going to do this? What do guys do? I decided to put together a cheese board, which is a little bit unusual. And for the help of Vinny over here, because Vinny works in a machine operatable area, we made a cheese board, an oak cheese board. What's the machine called? CNC router. We typed it out on the computer, and then we made this cheese board. Tom, do you think you'd hold it up? Do you want to walk around the room, Tom? Just walk around to each table, Tom. So yeah, so I decided to make this. I thought it was a bit different. And so Louise and I went to a lovely hotel in Bath. Went to a lovely hotel in Bath and I sat down. I got the waiter to turn the board upside down with some cheese on it. And we sat down and I had a nice chat with Louise. And then I mentioned that the cheese board was quite nice and she felt the bottom of it and it was a bit ridged because there's a ridge around it. And she's, ooh, and she looked around and so on. Then I moved the cheese off the board because it was already on the plate. She turned it over and I went straight down on one knee and got out a ring and I said, Louise, will you marry me? And I was very happy that she said she would. And she just has. So that was fantastic. So I would just like to say that during this time of knowing Louise for 2 years, I mean, her parents have been amazing towards me. They really have. they've taken me in as their own, and it's been fantastic to know you, and so much looking forward to our adventure, Louise and our adventure, and of course being involved and accepted in your family, Darren over there and Sarah and Freya, and Dean of course, Finley, Daisy, Yin, and it's just been amazing to have that, to have the sort of family feel, the family spirit. It really is. We had some lovely Christmases together already, and before we just hold up a toast, you know, I can't explain how excited, how delighted I am to have been, to have now today married my beautiful, caring and wonderful wife, and I mean that with all sincerity. And if you could just hold a glass up and say, to Louise. Thank you. Thank you, guys.
Ladies and gentlemen, can I have your attention, please? I've given up with doing the whole kind of in-flight thing. We're going totally freestyle. When I was watching Graham there for, I think it was an in-flight of 1 hour and 45 minutes, I suddenly realized, you know, despite 3 months of planning my own speech and being, as Graham says, a planner, I'm going to have to just freestyle for a little while to condense it down so that we get on with the actual dancing, which I quite enjoy. So this could be interesting because I really am a planner, as Graham says, like organization is my thing. So I feel a little bit nervous now. So I'm just going to put these sunglasses on because I think after Graham's speech, it might be tomorrow already. And we're not quite sure where we landed. Are we on the other side of the planet? So anyway, what can I tell you just from what I remember from those 3 months of hard script writing, unlike Graham who wrote his last night with a little bit of help. Took all my best material maybe. I can tell you that on this day, on the 20th of July, it was the first moon landing. So the first man landed on the moon. Which I think if you know Graham and Louise, you'll know that this was one small step for Louise, and one giant leap for Graham. My second interesting fact about today was that actually Adolf Hitler, in 1944, there was an assassination on him, which is quite bizarre because actually my mother-in-law's birthday is on the 20th of April, which is the same as Adolf Hitler. And if we actually do an anagram of woman Hitler, you get mother-in-law. I'm only joking. Sean and Lynn, I've got to know over the last 6 months, and actually, I really, as Graham said, would like to welcome them to Cornwall. It's going to be great to be sharing the future of the new Mr. and Mrs. Parker. And who knows what might happen in many of those rooms that he's got. How many people? We had 50 people here today. Anyway, exciting times ahead, I'm sure. As I said, this is freestyling, so could be fun. But anyway, what I would like to say is that Lynn and Sean, this guy hasn't got a better kind of second family, which links into me saying, sorry, Ruth. Because if my mother-in-law there, she'll probably kill me later. But she is one of the best, and so is John. You might have met John, my father-in-law. But if he had the same relationship with my in-laws, it's going to be a great kind of future for you guys. We're in hotels, and I got kind of a lasting memory I'd like to share with Louise, because it's quite a quick win, really. I was a porter, and I'd been servicing the chambermaids and the receptionist, sorry. No, I mean, I was doing my services as a porter, just generally helping out. When I finally got to the kitchen to see Graham, who, by the way, was a barman, at least 6 minutes away from his post, coming out of the fridge, all wide-eyed, happy as punch. He had a nice slither of pink beef in his hand and a nice piece of cake. And I said to Graham, what are you doing over here? He was like, Anyway, short story is, the quickest way to this man's heart is he's got a sweet tooth. And you can't go wrong with a double dip of custard cream. Well, he hasn't even eaten his dessert. It must be his wedding day. Things change. Maybe it's the company he keeps.
No, I've eaten mine. That's Louise's.
Yeah. Oh, right. Well, that someone had a good figure. Anyway, the secret to your marriage will be now having custard creams in the house so you can double dip them, having Scotch eggs and a Battenberg slice. That really is the thing that he's after, honestly. Robin, you're in the church today, and I don't think there was a dry eye in that church. The things you said, and this will link in nicely, is that Rosemary and Michael aren't here today. And the thing I would like to say, if I was being sincere, not trying to be jokey, is that if Louise had met the Michael and Rosemary, I just know they would absolutely have loved her. They're like, see, I can hear Michael now. If I was doing my reels pitch, he would have been, yeah, give Graham a good ribbing in his best, like, BBC English. But yeah, he deserves that. You've gone light on him for two stag do's. You should really be cutting into him. And now he's just done that speech to me and killed my speech. And I can definitely see Rosemary, because a joke of yours, actually, is that they call her Isaiah, because one eye is Isaiah. She would be looking at me kind of like, if I had gone down the route I was going to go, what's Danny saying now? What's he doing? But I don't want to disappoint her. I really don't want to disappoint her. So I'm just going to cut out all the bits I was going to do, reading cards, because we want to get on with this evening. Just say that I've got to call someone. If you could just bear with me, because this will change a lot of things. If I can find my phone, hang on.
Bank manager.
Hello, are you there? Yeah, it's got to that point. Yeah. You still busy with Megan and Ryan? Harry, Megan? Okay, hang on. Where are you doing an exorcism up Old Hill? Can you get down here? Old Hill, by the way, is only up that hill up there. You're at Old Hill. Okay, how long will it take you to get here? Because this is dying on its ass. Really is. Seriously, this is dying. I need you. How long will you be? 2 minutes. Hang on, I'll show you where it is. Bear with me.
Nicer crowd than Harry and Meghan's wedding. What a beautiful audience we have here tonight. Why don't you give yourselves a big round of applause? Come on. Yeah! I can feel the energy in the room now. I don't want to preach to you all today, But then I look at these bridesmaids and I feel good! Because I know there's a God somewhere! You can call his name Lord! You can call his name Lord! Do you love him? Can you feel him? Do you feel the joy? I said, do you feel the joy?
Yes!
Can I hear an amen?
Amen!
Don't be ashamed to call his name.
Fred.
I don't know what you came here to do, but I came to praise. So what can I say about these two? Fornication! Yeah, that's right. For an occasion like this, it's important to give the bride and Louise some advice. It's important to give them some real advice. So what can I say? Now, the life of a human being is a long journey. From selfish to selfless. That's not to say you should not stop caring about yourself. You know, I let myself go. 10 years I was there. But I feel a large part of maturity is understanding that your immediate gratification isn't the most important thing in the world. Now, some of you may have come here in a boat, or even a car. You know, an automobile. Well, marriage can be a hard road, and it certainly ain't all plain sailing. It's definitely worth the trip. Now, some of you will know the internet is a powerful tool. And because of that tool, we all get to experience what true love is all about. I'd like to share a poem about friendship. Two little dicky birds sitting on the wall. One named Peter, one named Paul. Fly away, Peter. Fly away, Paul. Come back, Peter. And come back, Paul. Into the gardens of Gilead they go, looking for worms that hide down low. Peter can't find one, neither can Paul. Go back home, Peter. Go back home, Paul. Now, what's the moral of this poem, you ask? Well, when you get married, it's very easy to lose connection with your friends. Send them away. You may even lose faith at times. Hell no! But I can bet you on your rosary beads that the congregation gathered here today wants you to succeed and find the work. And that all of us never are but a stone's throw away, should you reach out to us. The Harbour wedding is a place here on this coast where we gather like tall ships of 98 to mourn and pledge and to keep these two in shelter, especially to protect them from the rough waters and the snappy, snappy alligators here in the south. Can I hear an amen?
Amen.
I can't hear you.
Amen. Amen.
Can I hear an amen for my brothers in the back?
Amen.
Can I hear an amen for my sisters to the left, to the right, and the back?
Amen.
Hallelujah.
Hallelujah.
Now my last piece is small. Not my friend here, Tom. I'm talking about myself. But I'd like to share with both of you. As you consummate your marriage, I'd like to present you with a small token of appreciation, a memento to take you forward as you paddle, meandering the waters of life. It comes with some instruction, and I've named it 50 Blades of Grey.
Thank you.
face towards the stern of the vessel, reach towards the stern, and insert the blade and tip in the oar of the ocean as you lean back towards the vessel's bow. The blade of the oar sweeps the water, the stern, providing forward thrust. May this take you to the edge of where you need to go.
Thank you very much, Ray.
Thank you.
I want all the couples in the room to look at each other and face each other. All the couples in the room, face each other. Put your hand on top of the other. Place your hand on top of everyone in the room. Are you all looking deeply into each other's eyes? Now, statistically, are you looking at the person most likely to murder you? Now, we're all friends. You're safe. You'll kill me first. So, at last, I would like to make a toast to the bride and groom, Louise and Graham, the new Mr. and Mrs. Parker. May you both be happy on your next part of your journey, living life full together. God bless and have a great night. Obama out. For Mr. and Mrs. Parker, Louise and Graham, for their first dance as a married couple.
My love has come along.
stars. I wanna die in your arms. Oh, oh, oh. She get lighter the more it gets dark. I'm gonna give you my heart.